Okay, so welcome everybody to the fourth and final talk of the series of Gnode lectures. Today we want to focus on putting all these things together that we learned last time. So last time we have talked about the components of Gnode and the different classes of component, and today we want to have a look on what to do with those components, how to compose systems out of those components. The talk will as structured as follows. First, I will tell you more about different options with regard to virtualization techniques that may be employed on Gnode. So there's a whole range of different possibilities that can be pursued, and I will try to motivate the different approaches. Secondly, I will highlight an interesting pattern that we increasingly use in Gnode that's called enslaving services. But this will only be a brief part of the talk. In the next part, I will talk about the challenges that we have to face as soon as workloads get dynamic. So Gnode promises to be a system that combines high robustness and security with dynamic workloads, and I will get more specific about what this really means. And the final part of the talk will introduce you to several topics that we are currently working on and topics that we are interested in working on in the near future. And this will just give you a kind of inspiration of where to go from here. And I hope that this will spawn your interest in following the project further. So first, let's take a look at various virtualization techniques that arise when using Gnode. Basically, there are five different flavors of virtualization techniques that we cover somehow. The first flavor is faithful virtualization, which is basically the idea that you use an unmodified guest operating system and simulate the whole hardware that is normally used by the operating system. So you have a complete virtual hardware platform. And of course, there are well-known examples, for example, VirtualBox, VMware, and KVM doing this approach. And on Gnode, there is at least one solution available that can be used or can be used in the future for this. The next category is paravirtualization, where the basic idea is that a guest OS kernel is slightly modified in order to run on the host platform. So the general pattern here is that the guest OS userland is binary compatible, but the kernel has to be slightly adapted. Next flavor is OS level virtualization. Here we consider changing the userland, or at least not changing the userland in terms of source code, but in terms of binaries. So we change the toolchain used by the userland to come up with a system that looks like an familiar OS, but it's indeed tailored to the host system. The next, even more fine-grained approach is process-level virtualization. So in the previous categories, we always looked at the whole operating systems as kind of personalities. And in this this flavor is basically quite related to Gnode in particular. It concentrates only on a single process or a sub-tree of processes. And finally, an even more fine-grained approach is to tailor the runtime of the process, so in particular the C runtime. And it's also one possibility that is quite unique to Gnode, and I will present you some examples. So first, when looking at faithful virtualization, most solutions require a CPU with virtualization support, so this makes virtualization drastically easier. So there are solutions such as VirtualBox that work with CPUs that do not feature hardware virtualization support, but those are pretty advanced. Use pretty advanced techniques like writing code, binary patching, and stuff like that. So if for using a hypervisor that has low complexity, those techniques are not viable. So in general, we we anticipate virtualization support. So this comes typically with Intel VT or AMD SVM, and newer ARM chips also support virtualization. So right now, two kernels of the Genoa-based platforms have support for this kind of CPU features. These are Nova and Fiasco OC, whereas on Fiasco OC, we do not really use those features yet. So the virtual machine monitor, that's the part of the solution that that emulates the actual platform. So it emulates the CPU, the virtual CPU, the guest physical memory, and the devices that the virtual platform comes with. And the point is that no guest OS modifications are required. So when looking at virtualization products, most products incorporate certain mechanisms needed for virtualization into the operating system's kernel. So, for example, if you look at KVM, there is a quite significant part of the virtualization support in the Linux kernel, and the same for VirtualBox. So, and consequently, these parts are added to the trusted computing base of a system. There is a solution that is different. That's Vancouver, the Vancouver Virtual Machine Monitor on top of Nova. It's basically it's a normal userland process. It runs as a Gnode node here in this example. So so it's from the perspective of other processes running in the system, it's not more privileged or it's not a special process, but it has exposure to some kernel features that are used for reflecting virtualization events to the userland. So this Vancouver Virtual Machine Monitor implements virtual CPU, virtual RAM, and virtual devices over here, and then can start an unmodified guest operating systems that runs basically in the same Gnode node. The interesting point here is that those virtual machine monitors can be instantiated any number of times. So you could run three machines in parallel, and they still don't have the virtual machine monitor in the trusted computing base. Each has its own instance of a virtual machine monitor, so there is no chance for having crosstalk between virtual machines through the virtual machine monitor. That's fairly cool. So in this scenario, the virtual machine monitor is in a way a protocol stack implementation, if you remember the categories of the last talk. So this is a practical example how such a virtual machine is configured in Gnode. So if you start a Vancouver node, you can specify in pretty detail how the machine looks like. So you see the typical peripherals like keyboard and mouse. These are attached to some kind of virtual bus over here, and basically this description allows you to construct a custom virtual PC out of different peripherals that are available in Vancouver. So here's, for example, the memory controller, and there's a PCI host bridge over here, and here's the virtual CPU. So at runtime, the virtual machine monitor functions in a way that these steps are taken as a kind of script that are plugging in the different components onto a virtual motherboard. So I think that's a pretty unique way of configuring machines. So that's the reason why I'm really a fan of Vancouver. In the second part here, you see multi-boot configuration. So here we make certain boot modules available to the virtual machine through the multi-boot protocol. So in this case, we start a virtual machine on Nova that starts the Fiasco kernel over here, and it has also Strap and Sigma 0 and 4 as boot modules available. So the next category is Parker virtualization. So you are probably familiar with FO Linux because Björn has talked a lot about and you have certainly had some practical experiences with that. So the advantage of Parker virtualization is that virtualization support in C is not needed for that. So it can be used on current generation ARM platforms. And basic idea is that the kernel is the guest kernel is a bit modified. It's basically ported to a new platform, but this platform is not available in hardware. It's just a virtual platform that's available on software, a microkernel platform. The user land is of the guest OS is compatible, so you could use any normal Linux distribution on for Linux. But yeah, as I said, the guest OS kernel head has to be modified, and the modifications are inherently specific for the used kernel. So, for example, on Fiasco OC, the vCPU feature of the Fiasco OC kernel is used to manage the control flow within the Linux kernel and the handling of interrupts. On OKL4, the whole emulation scheme is different. So there are specific OKL4 specific synchronization mechanisms used, for example. And this also implies that the virtualization involves ongoing maintenance. So if a new version of Linux comes out, someone has to apply the modifications to the new version. So here's an example picture that is displaying two nodes of L4 Linux. One node displays L4 Android running on as a process node in Linode, and another node executes L4 Linux. Again, that's the same pattern as in the faithful virtualization case. Those nodes are leaf nodes in the process tree, and they are running inside the sandbox over here. So there is no need to trust any of those both nodes when running coding. That's important. So in this picture, these arrows here, they illustrate that the Linux instance communicates somehow with the rest of the Linode world, and this is done by custom stub drivers that are implemented in the Linux kernel. So that these drivers translate Linux kernel API calls to Gnode services. So, for example, there's a driver that translates, that implements a Linux networking driver, but it forwards networking packets to Gnode's next session interface. And those are the stub drivers that are implemented. For example, there's a terminal stub driver that is visible as a character device on the Linux user land. There's a block device driver that can be used to attach Gnode block drivers to Linux, and those blocked sessions will then appear as dev SDA, for example. This is the NIC stub driver. There's a frame buffer stub driver that appears at dev FB. And the same for input. And for OKL Linux, we also implemented support for Nitpicker, for this seamless integration of Windows, the X Windows system, and also audio output. The distinctive thing for when using L4 Linux on Gnode compared to L4 Linux L4 RE is that on Gnode we facilitate the approach that Linux should not access hardware directly. So this would somehow mix the different categories of components. This would be both a device driver and also a runtime environment, and we try to separate those concerns. So instead of having device drivers directly linked into L4 Linux, we try to run them outside and let Linux deal only with virtual hardware. The next category is OS level virtualization, and there are solutions available for Linux, for example, that simulate instances of Linux on top of one kernel by just a kind of a namespacing mechanism. And on Gnode, the idea is a bit different. The idea is to implement a Unix kernel interface, but as a RPC interface. So, when looking at such a task, implementing a Unix kernel interface, we have to face those kind of syscalls, which are typical Linux syscalls. And the cool thing is that those system calls are actually sufficient to run a large number of new utilities, for example, core utils, bash, and so on. So there are really a few of them, so for reading and writing to file descriptors or to getting information about file descriptors, to access the virtual file system, or to wait for events from file descriptors. Here for creating new processes, managing children, but it's really a small number of system calls that need to be implemented. If networking comes into play, we need a couple of more system calls for creating sockets, for listening to incoming direct connections, and to sending and receiving messages. But it's not really a huge list. It's really quite small. So compared to what we have on Linux, and Linux we have over 300 system calls. So how does it come up? How can we implement a kind of Linux-like kernel interface? Only such a few system calls leave out so many. So the point is that there are a lot of things that Linux needs to consider and we don't. For example, on this bootshell Unix kernel, we do not need to interact with device drivers. On Linux, of course, the kernel needs to initialize all devices and expose devices to the user land. So it needs to manage device nodes. It needs to expose device interfaces through I/O controls or proc devices and stuff like that. And on Gnode, none of these complexities is needed on this level. So this is just a container for executing software. There is no need to interact with device drivers directly. The second point is that of course, this OS, this user-level Unix kernel is not the fundamental of the system. It does not need to initialize the system. So the system is already initialized by Gnode. Was this OS-level virtualization kernel is just a normal process on Gnode, so we can skip all the init process and all the sequences like init.rb, mounting the file system, some stuff like that. We don't need to consider users and groups and discretionary access control at all. So the basic principle is that one instance is supposed to be never shared by multiple users. So of course on Linux is a multi-user operating system. We are expected to have support for multiple users in one instance of Linux. But here, it's quite the opposite. We expect that one user may run many, many different instances of this Unix emulation, so each instance serving a particular purpose. For example, when spawning a text editor, could just spawn a new instance of this virtual OS virtualization layer and run a single instance of the text editor in there and never share this between multiple users. Also, multi-threading doesn't need to be considered. So again, if you look at Linux, there are multi-threading APIs in the kernel, for example, for including POSIX threads on top. And this is needed because you want multi-threaded applications on Linux, for example, or in particular, GUI applications that are expected to use multiple threads. But all those nice command line with Unix processes, like compilers and tools and so on, that run on the command line, do not use multi-threading at all, so we can leave this out from the picture. And another important point is that scalability is much less of a concern in our case. Of course, with the approach of having a lot of different instances, the scalability of a single instance is not so important anymore. So again, if you look at Linux, you need a scalable file system, but the virtual file system must be fast, Linux must be fast. You need a block hash, a directory, and so on in order to scale. But if instance, the virtual Unix is extremely tied to a particular use case. For example, one instance compiling some source code, the stuff that to be in there is extremely limited. You only need the tool chain and shell and maybe some Unix core tools, but that's it. There's no need to have a scalable file system in there. So, because instance serves one specific purpose, and you can always associate a lot of instances if you would like to scale. So this is how it's like in Node. So this virtual Unix kernel is called Linux. It implements basically a virtual file system. That's over here. This virtual file system contains the ability to mount tar archives as a file system. So you can use one or multiple tar archives. These tar archives are requested using a ROM session from some other ROM servers, so and are now translated to a virtual file system over here. And furthermore, this is the concept of so-called I/O channels. So these are basically the backends of file descriptors. So, and these I/O channels are, there are initial I/O channels created for the in and output of the init process, and these I/O channels are connected to a terminal section that is connected to a terminal implementation, for example, a graphical terminal that is visible on screen, or a TCP terminal that is over the network via whatever, or telnet or something like that. So the Nux server is starting the init process. So this is basically a just recompiled Linux program. It's not modified in any way at the source level. It's just recompiled and linked again for custom FreeBSD-based C. And the C contains a kind of interface over here that allows us to customize the C library. So we can plug in the tweaks to the libc. And this plugin here translates the typical libc calls, such as open and read write, into RPC calls that are now directed to the Nux server over here. So this is basically an RPC interface between those processes. And all the system calls that we know from Unix are mapped to RPC calls. So the configuration of such a Nux instance is extremely simple. If you look at this example, this is an example for running Vim on Gnode using Nux. So just compile Vim using UMO configure make process and then include the resulting installation directory in the tar archive over here. So that's basically the normal process of compiling Vim, like configure make install, and the stuff that it gets installed ends up in this tar archive. Then we tell Nux to start bin as a init process. We set up certain environment variables. For example, we need to tell the Vim to use terminal emulation with Linux. And we can supply arguments to, for example, to say, okay, we don't want to have a file, or we want to run Vim not in VI mode, but in Vim mode. And that's it. So that's the configuration you need to run instance of Vim inside Gnode. The second example is more elaborative. So it is, shows you how to start an interactive bash shell on Nux. So the file system the table looks a bit more elaborative here. So we do not only mount one single tar archive, but we can mount multiple of them. And they are all overlaid. So all the binaries that are in each of those archives are visible in the global the Nux virtual file system. It's also possible to create directories on the fly. You can create a home directory over here and then mount a file system inside this home directory. And this fs over here is direct Nux to create a file system session. So go to the parent and ask for a file system session and attach certain label to this file system session. So it tells the parent, this file system session over here is supposed to be a home file system. And the same for the RAM directory over here. That's quite arbitrary. So it's just for an example. We just say, okay, we want to have another file system. This should have the label root. And we have a temp file system. This should be labeled. So these are informations that we pass down to the parent. And here we just spawn the bash shell contained in the archive and say the terminal. The counterpart of those file system requests is the so-called FS server. This is a in-memory file system, and this is the configuration for the that matches the Nux configuration over here. So here, first part, you see that you can preload the RAM file system with some content. So it is just for example, we can create a directory over here. Let's call it temp and put in a ROM file. The ROM init as some under file name something. And the same, we can create directory home and as directory user and place in there another ROM image. So this just tells you that we can populate the content of such in memory system pretty easily using Gnode config. And then the second part is the policy of what happens when a client creates a session to our service. So and this policy looks at, works as follows. If a client request comes in, the RAMFS checks if label, the session matches any of the labels over here. So if the label matches, or if the session comes from Nux instance and has the label root, so this is the one that we specified, the FS node in Nux, we apply the policy that this file system session refers to the root of the file system, so to this directory, and we hand out this file system. By default, it's handed out in read-only fashion. In this case, the file system just mounted over here this RAM directory will contain the whole RAMFS content, but only in a readable way. Second policy says that if the request comes from Nux and has the label home, then we hand out the part of the file system that is located under home user and have it also write. So the file RAMFS returns a virtual version of the file system that just contains stuff that's here. It's a local view on the file system. And similar for the temp directory, it's just handing out the stuff that's under the direct temp and write to the file system. So that's the basic concept of how Nux can at least stick together with the file system. So to summarize the features, we can run many unmodified packages of their world on using Nux. So this includes the known Gnode, all known utilities that we use Gnode Labs every day, like Vim and so on. The powerful feature here is that we can use so-called stacked file systems, so we can mount any arbitrary number of tar files or other file systems just using this overlaying mechanism. The cool thing here is because we can skip the initialization sequence of Unix and start an instance of in fractions of a second, so it's really as fast as the universally spawned shell can spawn a virtual instance of a Unix environment. The porting of those applications, like this one, is done in a way that we facilitate the use of the original build system. So we do not port, we do not change the integrate packages directly in the Gnode build system, but we just use the procedure that comes with the make files and configure scripts that of the packages. That means in practice that porting is extremely easy. In some cases, there is just no effort needed at all, just working out the box. In some other cases, some slight things must be fixed or patched, but this is really small, a very small effort needed. There are two versions of Nux, one minimal version, that's the core part of Nux, and one version that extends Nux with token capabilities. So basically, this includes TCP/IP stack. And the coolest thing about Nux is that it's extremely tiny, only 5,000 lines of code. So it's really, really small. So the next opportunity that we have, especially on Gnode, is that we can virtualize on a process level. And so the idea is that we can monitor and visualize individual session interfaces. So this makes it possible to monitor not only the session requests, but also the calls that are made to the session, and to modify the behavior of existing services. So this facilitates the general principle that policy and mechanisms should be separated. I will just give you an example, a practical example. Let's assume we have a Gnode process running on Node. This process is using a service, so this is a pretty basic scenario. Each process in the Gnode system is in some way connected to a service because it needs a RAM session, an RM session, a CPU session at core in order to execute. So through the tree of Gnode, there are some connections for these basic services. So now, if you want to debug this process, we have a really nice opportunity here. We can just transparently intercept the sessions that go from the Gnode process to core by a so-called monitor process, GDB monitor. And this one just provides the same interface as core, but it uses this local implementations to spy on the debugging target and also impose custom policies. So, for example, by virtualizing the CPU session over here, the GDB bean monitor gets aware of all the threads are created by the Genode process over here and gets control over all the thread capabilities that the debugging target processes. So it can, for example, house all threads in the debugging target by just putting the capability over here and invoking this capability at war. So by just intercepting the CPU session, we gain control over the execution of threads. The same is for RAM and for RM. So by intercepting the RAM interface, we get to know about all memory objects that are allocated by the gene process over here. So we can inspect all the data that are created, and by accepting the RM session, we know about the address layout of the debugging target and can track which data are attached to which position, and can build a model of the address space that we have very, very detailed information about what's going on here. In fact, the information is basically enough to implement a whole GDB stub in here that is communicating with the terminal service that's running as a separate service in Genode. This could be a TCP terminal or an EO driver. And this connected using to a remotely running GNU debugger. So, and the thing here is that even service requests, so the interaction between the debugging target and other parts of the system can be forwarded in a transparent way, so that the debugging target doesn't really know that it is running in a virtual environment. It can interact with components outside this virtual environment. And by sticking those both concepts, OS-level virtualization together with process-level virtualization, come up with this picture. This picture basically tells us that we can use the GNU debugger also as on target, so we can just forward the terminal session that goes to the terminal, normally through the remote GDB. We can connect this to the Nux instance and then attach a debugger that is running locally on the system. And voila, we have a target debugging Genode. So this is just an overview of the feature set currently supported by GDB Monitor. Right now, we have implemented the parts of the CPU session interface that are needed for debugging on FIASC and OPL4. So, but there is no principal problem implementing those features on other kernels. We have just have done so. So and the next candidate would be naturally support for the Nova kernel. And we can all have all these nice things like break by the user using a control key or by a segfault of the program. We can use source level debugging and backtraces. We can single step through code. We can even handle multiple threads. So that's really nice. Most Genode applications are multi-thread. And so we can just use GDB's threading facilities for debugging them. And the GDB also knows about dynamic debugging binaries. So it's very comprehensive. The last, the final opportunity for virtualization is to tweak the C runtime. So for this, we have turned the FreeBSD libc into a modular C runtime. So the basic libc library, the libsports directory, is basically a port of the FreeBSD libc. So from the API levels point of view, it's a very comprehensive C library. But we have complemented this library with the ability to plug in secondary libraries to the libc. So if such a plugin is present, the libc doesn't hand out file descriptors directly. So if an open request is made by the application, just not handle the open request in a predefined way, but it first asks any of the available plugins, if there's a plugin interested in serving this open request, and if some plugin signals interest in handling this particular opening of a file, this plugin can take over and can register itself as the manager of this specific file script. For example, if we want to forward the standard output of the C library to the log session of Linux, we just link this library, libc-log, and this library claims the ownership of the file descriptor 1 and 2. And by this, all of writer permissions are open, those file descriptors end up in this plugin and are handled in a way that they are, these operations are forwarded to the log service. In a similar fashion, if we link this libc-s in, each time we open a file, the libc-s plugin looks this file is actually contained in the file system, and if so, the libc-fs plugin is more control for this file descriptor. So our subsequent read and write operations are directed to this file plugin. A similar plugin exists for accessing ROM files, and yeah, there are of more, for example, the lightweight plugin extends the abilities of C with BSD rockets using lightweight. There is another plugin that directs operations not on a file system session, but directly on a workbox session using using the FHUD library. And there are some other plugins, for example, here that exposing a simplified pipe that we use for synchronization. And the picture gets complete with the ability to create application-specific plugins. And this technique allows us to tweak the C runtime for each application individually. So I will give you an example of this. So here you can see the super stack needed to get OpenGL running on Node. So it's a pretty elaborative project. We are looking basically on more than 300,000 lines of code that we want to use on Gnode, but we do not want to modify them, maintain them. So here you can see at a low level, we have hardware resources like a PCI driver, IO memory, so memory mapped registers, IRQs. But there we have a small Linux emulation environment layer over here that enables us to execute the kernel level GPU driver that's taken from the Linux kernel. So this is all running on Gnode userland. And so this code over here, that's the original driver code, is not modified. So it's just linked against the small emulation environment that exposes as similar API as the Linux kernel, so this runs happily within this Linux emulation environment. Then we have on the Linux kernel, normally we have an interface to the userland that's called DevDRM. This is a device that allows the userland to communicate with the kernel level GPU driver over here. And these interfaces typically a set of IO control functions that are implemented here and invoked from the userland. And furthermore, this kernel level driver manages its own memory regions using a MF interface also for the device. So a user level program can map buffers, so for example, pixel buffers or buffers for shader programs in a user level program by using MF on this DevDRM device. So because this this DevDRM device is pretty vendor-specific, so it looks different from when using Intel, from when using NVIDIA, for example. There is a library in the userland that's called libdrm that abstracts this access to the interface and somehow generalizes this interface. And this library, in turn, contains a lot of program. It's not really a wrapper. It's containing quite significant code. So we want to reuse this library as so on top of this library, we have the user level 3D driver that's here as a chat library. And then on top of that, we have the generic part of Gaium and Mesa 3D. And on top of that, we have those APIs. So there's a further special made component that's the EGL driver that attaches or that makes the application able to interact with the Gnode framework. So it's basically the glue needed between the Gnode frame buffer and the OpenGL software. So the point is we want to keep using all this code without modifications. So how to do that? So a very important trick to just tweak this DevDRM device over here. So on Gnode, we don't have any devices or device node. So we don't have even a namespace for these kind of devices. So what the solution is to link the libdrm to a custom libc plugin that just gets asked as soon as the libdrm tries to open the device. The plugin is asked, are you interested in handling this device? And the plugin says, yes, I'm interested in handling devdrm. So from this time on, all requests, all IO requests, or MAP requests end up in the plugin instead of somewhere else. So the plugin can handle all these requests by handing those requests down the software stack, for example. And this way, we can reuse the original libdrm code without any modifications, but by tweaking the environment, the runtime environment of libdrm a bit. Another much simpler example is the file system access on Gnode. This is a very simple scenario where an application is using the FFAT plugin to directly use a partition on a block device driver. So this is here the block session interface. It's based on a packet stream that I explained in the second lecture. So, and by using this libc FFAT plugin, this plugin contains the whole file system implementation, and it's using the block device session directly. And completely transparent to the application, we can just insert another plugin instead of the FFAT plugin. It's the libc FS plugin. This directs the file system related operations not to a block session, but to a file system session over here. So we can stick in a file system in between the block session, blocks device driver and the application, and this way can run multiple applications on one file system. But the important point is that from the application points of view, nothing changes at all. It's all the adaptation is all done in this plugin over here. So this is for the overview of the various options that we have with regard to virtualization on Gnode. The second part will explain a pattern that we find very, very powerful, and I try to motivate you to explore this pattern a bit in more detail. The basic idea is to run a service as a child. So in all the scenarios that we have seen so far, a server is somewhere running besides a child. It's some trusted instance that runs in some part of the process tree, and the child runs in another part of the process tree, and those made the child and the server arm are made known to each other using a parent. But the principle nature of Gnode allows a service to be executed as a child of another process as well. So the idea is to use this technique for sandboxing protocol stacks or other complex implementations that we would normally use as library, but by exposing this functionality as a service, we can just spawn a different process from a parent that executes this kind of protocol stack, and we this way sandbox this complex application logic. It facilitates the reuse of code. For example, if you want to to access a ROM image or file from tar archive, we could either implement code that parses a tar archive, or we can just use the tar ROM server as a child and pass tar archive as a ROM image to the child and let the child now decompose the tar archive in individual ROM files for us. So it's very easy to reuse such components. And this is also naturally useful as a plugin mechanism. So this is an example of how it can be used. In this case, we want to have a video player on top of Gnode. So we create a GUI based on Qt. It's basically the stuff that's over here. And this GUI does not contain any program logic for decoding a file, or there's no code for no codec and no media related stuff in here. So it's just running a different process. It's the code over here. So this is running as a child of this GUI process. And this is a port of the libav running in a dedicated process. It's using SDL audio and SDL video. In fact, this is basically the example application that comes with libav, that's AV play. So it's not actually changed at all. It's just the original application. So we spawn this, SDL base station from the GUI, and we pass down pass up a configuration file to this application. But that's a point I will refer to in a later stage. The important part is that when starting up, we tell this application to play a file called media. That's just an arbitrary file name. It doesn't matter how the file is named. So the codec will start and it will request a ROM session from the GUI for a media file. So the GUI virtualizes intercepts ROM session requests and will hand out any file of choice. So the codec has no access to any file system. It cannot access the network or anything. It just gets this ROM file from here, and the policy of the GUI how this file gets obtained. So the codec uses this file. It also the video backend creates a frame buffer session at the GUI. So again, it asks the parent, which is the GUI, for a frame buffer. What the GUI now does is it doesn't hand a real frame buffer, of course. It doesn't even hand out a nitpicker session or something. It creates a virtual implementation of a frame buffer over here. And under the hood, it creates a second nitpicker instance. So there are basically two nitpicker sessions created by the GUI. One is used for the GUI controls, and one is used for the buffer that displays the actual media data. And because the GUI knows where the window is located, it can place both views, so the views of belonging to the metadata and the view of its own, in a way that they both appear at the same part of the screen. So the codec is outputting the final video frame in this virtual frame buffer, which is displayed directly as a nitpicker view. So basically, all the video stream is bypassing the core QT static, which is also pretty nice because now you could principally run this codec at a high priority, for example, lower priority and have a fluent frame rate regardless of what QT is doing. At least in theory, we haven't done so. And this gets even further. So we can extend this concept by adding so-called effect plugins in a transparent way. So by just connecting the frame buffer request not directly to the virtual buffer, but creating multiple other processes that both request a frame buffer session, but also implement a frame buffer service. So they are some kind of filters. We can direct frame buffer session request not to this virtual buffer, but with an effect plugin. The effect plugin will again request a frame buffer session. This request will not direct it to this one, but to another plugin, and so on and so on. And the final effect plugin will also request a frame buffer session, and this one will end up in the virtual frame buffer over here. So here we have a whole chain of post-processing processes that the video's data is get passed through. And the good thing here is that these post-processing plugins use the ordinary frame buffer session interface of Gnode, so there's no special purpose interface needed between those. This is just the ordinary frame buffer session. So because we find this ability to run servers as slaves or as children very useful, we have a kind of API helper to simplify the use. So here's a very simple example. We have a custom policy that is inherited by from slave policy. We just express which services is the services are permitted to be used by a child. So in this case, we have this list of services. We tell the slave policy the name of the binary that we want to start as a child, and we implement the announce service function, which is called each time the child announces the availability of a service. So as soon as this function is called back from the child, the parent or the mainframe can make use of the service and invoke those the session and in the session interface of the service. And to instantiate a new child, basically we need an endpoint, of course, for the child to serve the parent requests. This is this entry point. We create an instance of policy over here, and we create a new slave passing the entry point policy into the slave, and that's it. So it's very simple to create subsystems, just as a kind of sandboxed programs. The third part of the talk will cover the difficulties that come with a dynamic workload. So as soon as most of the scenarios we have seen were pretty static, configured by the init configuration, and now I will go into a problem space that's with dynamic applications or dynamic workloads. The typical problems that come with dynamic systems are that we need to revoke resources. So once we assign resources to a process, when we want to kill the process, we need to get back the resource that we assigned. Also, another problem is that dynamic systems typically discover their environment at runtime, for example, the availability of devices in order to start the right device drivers, the amount of memory and things like that. So runtime discovery is a topic that comes in. And another problem is that the policies might change during runtime, so they cannot always be expressed in a static way. And dynamic policy changes comes the need for adaptive components that need to adapt their behavior at runtime. The first point is to destruct subsystems and evoking resources. There are a number of challenges that arise when we look at the problem. For example, once we release resources, there's an inherent problem that resources may not be released, not all resources may be released, and we have resource leaks. So typical problems are memory leaks, for example. So this is bad from a resource utilization point of view, but it's not it's not going to make your system independent in a way. But the second problem is much worse. Because if resources are freed that are referenced somewhere, we might have a big problem once those references are used again after the resources are not available anymore. There we have the problem of locked resources. So for example, if a device driver is moved from the system, and the device driver used certain device resources exclusively, and we kill the device driver in an unclean way, these resources may still be locked, and the other device driver can reclaim them again. And another problem is that if you have a distributed system such as Gnode, where an application uses a bunch of servers to get its work done, and the application disappears, we need to clean up state at each server that the application was using. So in Gnode, all these problems are addressed in a very simple way. The basic idea is that the parent of a process or of a subsystem just closes all sessions created by the subsystem in reverse order. So that's basically the same thing the destructor does in C++. Destruct an object, all the destructors of base objects and the destructors of the member variables are executed, but in a reverse order of construct. That's the basic idea here. The nice property here is that from the server side, the server cannot really decide whether the client is in the process of destructing a child or whether the child is just closing a single session. It looks the same, and the server handles both cases in the same way. So there's no need to have a special handling code in the server that handles with this appearance of a child. Another nice property is resource donations that clients donated to the server are all reloaded. So we take all the resources that the client had in the process of closing all the sessions. And so when the full process is finished, all the resources are now are attributed to the child that we are going to kill. And so we have regained all the resources as well. And another interesting point that this doesn't only work for a single process, but for arbitrary complex subsystems containing any number of nodes and children and child grandchild. because from the viewpoint of the parent, it all looks like those sessions originate in the immediate child process. So next problem I want to cover is the application of the slave pattern for detecting mood medium. So this is part of the discovery problem. So let's say we have this init process. The init process wants to start a system from a live CD. So there may be several options. For example, this live CD may be installed on a real CD-ROM accessed through Atapi, or the image may be installed on a SATA disk, or probably the image may be installed on a USB stick. So it's very difficult for init, it's actually impossible for init to guess where the same image is booted from. It needs to discover where the boot medium really is. And for doing this discovery, we have introduced this so-called device driver manager, or demo device driver manager, which is D3M. And this device driver manager has the goal to provide one block session to the init process that contains the boot medium. And to find out where the boot medium is and which driver to use, it performs a probing procedure. And this probing is implemented using the slave pattern. So in this case, it first starts the USB driver over here, the USB storage driver, and waits until the USB storage driver announces a block session. So this is this block session. Once the block session is announced, we start an instance of the ISO file system to access this block session. And so this is now, when starting the ISO server, it will request block session. We just connect this request to the just announced USB storage block device. And then we use D3M uses the server announced by the ISO file system to open a JIT file. And we observe the result of this request, so of this session request. And if the file is there, this will out well. If the file is not there, we get an exception, and we know, either the USB storage doesn't working correctly, or the file system doesn't have this magic file, something went wrong, so this is certainly not the right boot medium. And the similar procedure is going on over here on the right side. So it starts, the Atapi driver. The Atapi driver announces a block session by block service. This block service is then again used by another instance of the ISO file system, which is then used by D3M to open the magic ROM file. And now in this case, there's really a CD attached to the CD-ROM drive containing a magic file. So the open request succeeds, and D3M knows that the Atapi driver is the right one. It can just forward this block service to the init process. So from init's point of view, this is all transparent, and the whole logic in this region just uses the creation and destruction of subsystems to discover the environment. Another problem that we have on dynamic systems that we want to reconfigure a system at runtime. So there are typical examples like the user wants to change resolutions at runtime, or you want to change the audio mixer settings. So it's infeasible to have these kind of parameters specified in static configuration of the process. So you want to change those parameters at runtime. Another example is the touch screen calibration. So this is one example that actually motivates us to tackle the problem. So Ivan was creating a driver that was able to calibrate touch screens. And here you want to check the calibration parameters, and so the question is how to do that at runtime. So another problem is that once you have a windowing system in the terminal windows, you want to resize those terminal windows, you want to adapt the context of the windows correctly, or you want to implement a custom policy for a new pod plugin. For example, a USB stick is lacking, the user wants to select the policy, what to do with the USB stick. So this straightforward approach for each of those problems is, we can cover each problem with a custom RPC interface. Of course, we can introduce a new API. Then this was, when I remember right, the first approach that Ivan has taken as well. So introducing a new RPC interface to configure stuff in time. So this is basically the configuration interface of the service is another server, is another session, basically. And a configuration client can do this specific session and configure the server. The disadvantage here is that a new RPC interface makes the system more complex, of course. It introduces a new interface. But the more problematic thing is that the interface is inherently specific, not to the server's interface, but to the server's implementation. So the implementation of for example, the touchscreen driver implements the session interface. This is a very generic interface. The configuration options for the in driver is not specific for the input interface, but it's very specific for the implementation, for the touchscreen specific basically. Yes, and then another problem is that we already have some configuration concept. I explained the previous lecture that we use for static configuration, and now when combining this with the dynamic configuration, we have a kind of redundancy. So we have to decide which part of the configuration do we pass through the config, and which part of the configuration do we pass through RPC calls. I also have the problem that once server is running but it's not yet configured by the PC interface, we have a kind of transient state where we do not know how this component is configured. So we have a kind of bootstrapping problem as well, at least in an inconsistent initialization phase. So we seek a generalized solution, and the idea is to turn the static configuration mechanism into a dynamic mechanism. And it turned out that this is really simple. The idea is to enhance the session interface by one single function, which allows a client to respond to changes of the ROM module that we requested via the session. So this whole idea here is that ROM module is not considered to be as immutable over runtime or over session creation time, but that we consider a ROM module to change during session time. And each time a ROM module changes its content, the server, issues a signal to the client. The client can respond to the signal by reacquiring the session resources. In this case of the ROM session, the client can just request the data space again, and then get a new copy of the ROM data. So this is, in a way, this is similar to the iNotify mechanism that we know from Linux, where the client can respond to events that concern the files. And here, the end is the single ROM module. So I'll give you a brief example. Again, we have this mid layer, so we provide the configuration to the config, and a part of the configuration is volume that is used by the audio backend of the codec. And when we change the audio volume here at the GUI, the GUI will just update the configuration file, will just create a new config, changing the value over here, and issue a signal to the ROM session to inform the codec that the audio volume has changed. So the codec in turn, at least the SDL audio backend, responds to the signal by reacquiring the configuration file, so by fetching the data space again and parsing the configuration again, and then discovering, oh, the audio volume has changed. I adapt the audio volume. So we can always update the configuration from over here, and the SDL audio backend over here pulls in the new configuration and parses the configuration. So in a generalized variant, you could imagine to have part of the ROM file system to host also a ROM service. And this ROM service gets sends signals each time a file changes on the ROM file system. So this might open the possibility to change configurations at runtime using the RAM file system and passing them these configurations to the different processes in the system. So the general pattern here, so that we had used for the ROM service, is we install a signal handler in a session, and then the client responds to such session update signals and updates the mode of operation. So it's just a response to those changes. For example, if the frame buffer changes its size, the frame buffer server will just issue a signal to the client. The client will request a new mod, the frame buffer mode, and adapt to its to the new mode. And the important point is that those changes must be transactional, and this just happens to be the case for the ROM session, because the old database remains active, remains visible at the client side until the client explicitly requests the data space again. And at that point in time, the server is free to release the old data space and hand out the new data space. So we have a transaction. And yeah, finally, this works for ROM framework or terminal. I think that it might also work for a number of other use cases. Another interesting challenge is that by now we have started and stopped subsystems always at the children of a process. But there are cases where we do not want to create children, but we want to create a subsystem that is lower down the Gnode tree. For example, we have a shell. We have a very complex shell with a lot of features like auto-completion and so on. And we want to enable the shell to spawn a new subsystem, but we do not want to trust all the code in the shell with regard to the operation of the new subsystem. So you do not want the shell to have control over the new subsystem at runtime, during the runtime of the subsystem. So, and this can, of course, not be achieved by having the shell be the parent of the new subsystem. We have to come up with another solution. We want basically to couple the subsystem from the controlling software. And the solution for this is a loader service, which is a server that allows us to create subsystems on demand by clients that open a loader session, and the new subsystems are not running as the child of the client, but child of the loader. The important point here is the client pays for the new subsystem by donating session quota to the loader, and the client is also able to configure the subsystem, but once the subsystem runs, the client cannot interfere with the subsystem, with the internals of the subsystem. It can only revoke the resources, or it can close the loader session and close the subsystem, kill the subsystem, but cannot interfere with the subsystem. And here you see a practical example. So this example is actually can be found on the live CD of Gnode. We have the web browser, the Aurora web browser, that comes with a lightweight IP stack. So this is a Qt-based web browser. It's extremely complex, so we do not want to have the whole browser and also computing base for sensitive applications. But we want to use the browser as kind of launching tool for launching Gnode applications. So, and for this we have created a loader service. So the browser can create a session, the loader service, for creating new browser plugin. So this loader session is getting a binary data blob from the browser, which is basically an archive that contains multiple files, for example, a configuration, and also a bunch of binaries. So basically, the files that are not considered trusted at all, so they are fetched from somewhere from the net. Like a zip archive, browser downloads the stuff, passes this archive down to the loader unpacks the archive and instantiates the subsystem out of the archive. So and in this case, the loader instantiates an init process. The init process contains or starts again an init GUI and virtual frame buffer that in turn connects to the real init GUI. and it also starts a launched application. So basically, the Gnode demo scenario is contained in the tar archive. So, and the whole thing looks like this. So here we have the Aqua web browser running, and this part of the screen, this part of the browser window, is just covered by another Elpigger session that is started directly by the loader. You can see this in the label here. So here we have printed loader over here. So this is a child of directly of the loader. And here we have the over web browser, the huge trusted coding base. And this mechanism allows us to fetch a kind of critical application from, for example, a banking website, let's say. So the application come in the form of this archive. So, and it will be passed to the loader. The loader might validate the archive, so it might check a signature or use a decryption to decrypt the archive or apply whatever security measures that are needed, and then instantiate the subsystem. The subsystem will then interact with Nitpicker directly, so it's not going to any user interaction with the plugin is not visible by the browser. It's direct connected to, between Nitpicker and the plugin. So they are both the browser and the plugin are completely isolated from each other. So the browser cannot inspect or manipulate the plugin. Also, the plugin doesn't even know that there is a browser. So even though both parts are tightly integrated into one GUI, those parts are completely isolated from each other. And this can be taken even further. So, for example, this archive could come with a complete Linux kernel, with an L4 Linux kernel. And this L4 Linux kernel might then use a special block driver, virtual block driver, that converts block session requests into HTTP requests. So this block driver comes with its own TCP/IP stack. And both this Linux kernel and the HTTP block driver are connected to a network bridge, to the NIC bridge. And so we have basically, when running the scenario, we have three IP addresses, one for the web browser, one for the HTTP block driver, and one for this Linux kernel. And we can run the Linux kernel as a plugin in the web browser that uses HTTP requests for accessing the virtual block device, which is pretty cool, I think. So now that I have outlined several of how systems can be composed out of components, I want to give you an overview topics that we are currently working on or that we are interested in. So the big picture is that this year we want to reach the state where we can use Gnode as our primary OS, so for doing development work like compiling and editing our source code and stuff like that. So for doing this, we have reiterated over our needs that we have each day. So these are basically the fundamentals that we need. Also, we need a text editor, preferably Vim. We, of course, need a toolchain. We want to have a web browser and a way to view PDF files. We want to have some kind of convenient window manager to interact with multiple programs at the same time. Then, of course, we need some networking tools like FSH and a way to access a Git repository. We need to encrypt our at least a part of our block devices, and for all stuff that we cannot cover natively on Node, we want to have a kind of fallback virtual machine where we can do stuff on Linux from time to time. For example, if we receive a doc file from somewhere, that we can just start this virtual machine and view the file over there. And in addition to these features, there are a lot of nice to have features we would like to have, but they aren't really essential. For example, wireless networking and or Emacs or some multimedia stuff. So these points will probably be covered at a later point. As an intermediate step, we are planning to create a new live CD that covers several scenarios that are important to us when considering Gnode as a general purpose OS. Of course, we want to present the web browser and also the capability to replay media, present the fallback VM, and also, and that's quite the most important part, to run the toolchain natively on Gnode Unix, and also present how it's on target by using GDB. Another interest project that we are working on is the idea to run Gnode not on a kernel but on raw hardware. So the basic observation is that typically if you take a microkernel and combine this with Gnode, with Gnode's core, we end up with trusted computing base of more than 20,000 lines of code. So because the kernel has 10,000 lines, core has 10,000 lines, so we always are beyond 20,000 lines of code. So inherent, and most kernels are in fact much larger than 10,000 lines of code. So the idea is, if both parts, the core and kernel, are both always part of trusted computing, they are both ultimately trusted. Why not put both into one program? And this would lead to quite drastic reduction of redundant data structures. For example, most kernels keep an internal kernel mapping database in the kernel to keep track of memory mappings, and core we also need to keep track of the information which process owns which data space or which data space at which address. So there is a redundancy over here. We could remove this internal mapping database, and furthermore we could also all dynamic memory allocations from this kernel part, because that dynamic memory allocation can be done in the core part, and there we have proper allocators and proper management schemes, and there would be no need to do dynamic memory management in the kernel. So, and finally, the interaction between kernel and root tasks used to impose a certain complexity on the kernel side, because this interaction is basically the same as with any other userland process, so it must be done using IPC or special syscall and so on, and this interaction between both parts, this interfacing can be done much simpler. And yeah, and we did this experiment on ARM, on the ARM for V7 architecture, and created a kind of hybrid between kernel and core. And as a result, we ended up with a variant of core that runs natively on the ARM V7 architecture, and this has only 13,000 lines of code. So we see that we have slashed the trusted computing size for the most basic components by nearly the half of complexity. The next problem that we are working on is to get Gnode to compile on Gnode, so using Linux runtime environment. So that's the basic approach. And the other approach is that we want to do not change anything in our build system. We want to use the build system as is. So currently, we can execute a lot of existing programs like the GNU compiler collection, build utils, and so on. So a lot of the basics are already covered, but there are still a lot of corner cases of the POSIX API to cover. And of course, we need to thoroughly test the stability and performance of the scenario. So because the full chain is quite complex. Another working topic is the enablement of Unix networking tools that use each day, like fetching files from the network or SSH or using an SSL connection. And the basic approach is that to include the lightweight IP stack into the Linux runtime. So we have already done this, but this is ongoing work. And so the pattern here is that we have one TCP IP stack per Linux instance that does networking, but we can also create Linux instances that do not have TCP IP at all. So they are guaranteed to be isolated from the network. So in this way, each Linux instance will appear using a different IP address on a local network. So even if there is a bug in the TCP IP stack, this bug cannot affect the instances, but it's constrained to a single instance. Then there are a field of topics related to file access. So right now we have two file system implementations. One is the in-memory file system that I already mentioned, and the other is a FAT implementation based on libfat. And of course, we want to have a more advanced file system for using Gnode in practice, which has transitional semantics, so we can basically recover from unexpected power failures, for example. Then we also want to avoid fragmentation using a better block allocation mechanisms than used in FAT. And another nice thing would be to have a file system that is compatible with Linux some way, so that we can copy files initially using Linux and just plug it into Gnode. So of course, an ext file system comes into mind, so it might be ported to Gnode. Yet another working topic is the Vancouver Virtual Machine Monitor that I have outlined at the beginning of the talk. So it's announced the faithful virtualization on PC hardware. And the really cool thing about this combination, Vancouver and Nova, is performance is near native. It's 99% of native performance, so it's extremely fast. It's it's one of the fastest virtualization solutions that is available. But on Gnode, it's not yet usable right now. So it's able to bootstrap other kernels. For example, we have used Fiasco OC or Pistachio as a guest OS, but the implementation is not complete. So right now, we don't support interrupts. So after bootstrapping kernels, we just stop. So consequently, there are a lot of working topics, for example, enabling the use of interrupts, booting the Linux kernel, and then integrate the whole thing with the Gnode session interfaces to integrate the virtual machine well with the rest of the Gnode system. Another nice topic is the host of the Gnode website on Gnode. So for this, we have already created a static version of Gnode hook in the spring. So this is basically one precondition that we think must be done. We have the TCP stack and also the NIC drivers that are needed. So this gives us the options to create a new web server program, which is just able to hand out static web pages, which would be simple, or to port a web server directly to Node using the C library and the libc IP plugin. Or at another option, we could use a web server and run it as a Nux process using the NuxNet variant. Another quite crazy idea is to extend Linux, the Linux-based platform, the ability to use capability-based security. So normally, Linux lacks such a mechanism, does not provide capability-based security, but there is a feature in Linux that principally would allow to do this. Because file descriptors are, in a way, like capabilities, so there's a local namespace of descriptors in each process, so they are a bit like capabilities. So, and then now the key element here is that Unix domain sockets can be used to transfer file descriptors from one process to the other. And here we have capability delegation. And then the other thing is, of course, that we can send messages to those files before we can just create, for example, a Unix domain socket, we get a file descriptor for that, and send this file descriptor to another process. And finally, the new process can send a message to this file descriptor, and this way we get capability invocation. So we have those three elements of capabilities here. And by combining this with some basic mechanism to constrain the namespace of the files for the process using change root, for example, we could just change Gnode to do not use any files at all, except in core, and use the transfer mechanism of file descriptors for interaction between processes only. So, and this way we could get capability-based on Linux, which is quite fancy, I think. But it's still uncertain if this will really out. So it's kind of a research opportunity over here. Another point of interest for us is the support for ARM platforms. So in most recent time, we have concentrated on ARM4, the motherboard, created HDMI and USB drivers, networking, and SD card drivers, which are at least we can talk about networking and SD card. So those drivers are basically matching performance of native Linux system running on the motherboard. Another challenge that we face is the multiprocessor support in kernels that do not perform the multiprocessing in a transparent way. So, of course, on kernels like Linux or Zero, where SMP is done completely transparent, this can be leveraged by Gnode right now. But there are kernels such as Pistachio or, in general, S4 kernels that have an explicit API for dealing with CPUs. And so, the challenge here is to come up with a platform-independent way of configuring and programming those multi-Microsoft systems. Yeah, that's really a challenge. And the problem is basically similar to the problem of supporting real-time priorities. So there are a subset of kernels that provide this feature. So and the challenge is how to make this feature available in a coherent and generic way, but that does not break expectations of programmers when those configurations are or software components are applied on platforms that lack those features. It's a quite difficult design problem at API level. Another point that we are currently looking at is ARM Trustzone. This is a quite it's a very well hyped topic right now. So Trustzone promises a solution for making mobile more trustworthy by basically separating a device into two worlds, the secure and insecure world. So this separation is partially done in hardware. So there is hardware support for this two-world approach and special mechanism to switch between those worlds. And switching mechanism is basically supervised by a kind of hypervisor. It's called Monitor Mode in Trust. And our idea is to run Gnode in the secure world and run a Linux instance in the non-secure world. And at least in principle, it should be possible to run Linux unmodified in the non-secure world and just run Gnode besides. And that's currently an experiment that we are pursuing. And the idea is that Gnode contains all the trustworthy parts and is also responsible for bootstrapping and supervising the non-secure world. And the provider of security functions of the device. For our experiments, we are using the base HW platform, which is the version of Gnode that runs natively on the ARM hardware. So that's the base of our experimentation. And okay, now that I have mentioned those topics, there are a lot more topics to cover. For example, there is one approach that we are taking with regard to device drivers or device driver reuse that is so-called lightweight device driver environments, which basically comes down to the idea to create a custom library for each class of device driver that you want to use from Linux, for example. And this library is providing the kernel API used by the respective device driver. And so this is basically the advanced of the next step beyond the DDE that you probably heard about. So we experienced that the Linux DDE approach leads to a very, very complex driver emulation environments, and we came up with the conclusion that a generic device driver environment for Linux drivers adds a lot of overhead, and to the system, it's extremely hard to debug, and it consumes resources. And debugging stuff in this huge device driver environment is really a pain. So we came up with the idea to have this very tight device driver environments that are tightly coupled to the device drivers. And those device driver environments, they tend to be extremely tiny. For example, the device driver environment for the IPv4 networking drivers, it's in the cap of less than 1,000 lines of code. It's really extremely simple. The device driver environment for the GPU driver is, I think, less than 3,000 lines of code. And for the USB stack that we ported from Linux, it's also 3,000 lines of code. So that's at least the order of magnitude. So you see that the number of lines of code in this environment is extremely tiny compared to the actual code that we are to use. And this is in large contrast to the previous generation of device environments. So this is approach that should be applied to a lot more device drivers, I think. Another topic is to the support of IOM use of the Nova hypervisor, on top of the Nova hypervisor. Then there's an ongoing project to port Gnode and to the Helios Spartan kernel, which is developed university in Prague. Another interesting topic is to look at the OSS system support for Gnode. Another idea is to create a virtual NAT that could be used as a replacement of the NIC bridge component that would basically implement network address translation on a virtual network within Gnode. Another interesting topic is to combine Gnode with FPGAs. So basically, there is already a port that runs Gnode on the MicroBlaze soft core that is used on Xilinx FPGAs, and there's ongoing work to tightly integrate hardware peripherals in the FPGA with a Gnode system running on the same FPGA. Yet another challenge is trusted computing. We believe that trusted computing mechanisms can be combined with Gnode mechanisms in a very useful ways. Basically, that Gnode could actually enable the useful application of those trusted computing mechanisms. And another topic is to go beyond one single system, but to consider a kind of distributed system of Gnode nodes, a network of Gnode nodes, but to apply the same principles of Gnode between those nodes, so to also have a hierarchy of systems that are connected over the network. And yeah, of course, there are all these new platforms to discover and to conquer, like the Xen hypervisor could be a potential base platform for Gnode, the Berefish kernel or the SELF4 kernel, and there are a couple of more potential candidates. And another scope that could be discovered is the scope of languages, like looking at D or Rust, Haskell, or using any of these languages as systems languages in the case of Gnode would be an interesting topic to work on. So yeah, today we covered the various ways of combining Gnode's components into compositions of components. We talked about the challenges that we have to face as soon as workloads get dynamic, and I gave you a brief overview of the current topics that we are working on. Yeah, what could you do next? So basically, there are beyond those topics that I just outlined, there are a lot of small topics that are described in our issue tracker. So you could join the mailing list for discussing topics with us. Check out the issue tracker to see what problems, bugs, and feature requests are there. There's a compilation of ideas that we have put together, similar to the ventures that just talked about, might use for inspiration, and of course start getting and study on the code. So yeah, thanks for your attention.